In 2003, we were called down to the Cedar Fire. It's orange everywhere and smoke is blowing. And I just see the rows of houses burning. I see horses running wild, trying to escape the flames. That was my first experience in fire at that pace and scale of chaos and destruction. And what I walked away with is, there has got to be a better way.
Fires have dramatically increased over the past 20 years in a way that climate scientists anticipated, but I don't think any of the rest of us really understood what the cost ultimately would be. We're seeing a human cost to communities and impacts around the world that are really unprecedented.
So the research group at Google was trying to find ways of using technology to help address fires and to help manage natural ecosystems. We realized one of the main issues was that there just wasn't a lot of good data for how fires spread or where they even were half the time. Because in a satellite image of the Earth, there's a lot of things that can be mistaken for a fire. Clouds reflecting sunlight, a pond that's reflecting light back into space, something that's hot like a smokestack. All these things could look like a fire, especially when you're looking at a relatively coarse pixel. We realized if we can pair satellites with machine learning and artificial intelligence, it was the perfect platform to generate real-time operational intelligence on fires. So we designed and built a camera in order to optimize for machine learning-based fire detection. We spent a long time testing it on an aerial platform, flying over controlled burns, trying to establish a baseline for what the machine learning algorithms would have to pick out. AI and ML will allow us to take the last 1,000 times we saw a particular spot on the Earth and estimate whether or not the images that we're seeing now have a fire in them or don't. So the Google team really focuses on the data. The Muon team is helping bring that to the first protoflight satellite.
At Muon, we are designing, building, and will be operating the FireSat mission.
FireSat is a program that we started with satellite experts and a number of nonprofits. It will be a new constellation of satellites in low Earth orbit and be able to see the whole globe every 15 to 20 minutes and spot a fire both when it starts and for its full evolution.
A number of satellites do many things, but FireSat is focused on the problem of wildfire.
Satellites today that are used to do detection and tracking for fires, they come by roughly once every 12 hours or have very low resolutions. At best, you're going to get something that's 2 or 3 acres in size before you can actually see a fire. The main improvement FireSat's going to provide is really this rapid temporal revisit, especially at the really high resolution needed to see the fires when they're very tiny in size, roughly the size of a classroom.
We've had more than 200 interviews with first responders and incident commanders across the globe to understand the diverse needs of people in this area.
I was a line firefighter for decades, and I finished as the state fire marshal of California. So I was aware of some information gaps in the firefighting space. This is a global data stream that will be distributed for the use of first responders to get to places to protect communities and ecosystems quickly. And that's just the firefighting part.
We also want to provide data to fire scientists so that they can improve models of fires.
The foundation of all of our fire behavior modeling systems is the Rothermel fire spread equation, developed by Dick Rothermel in the 1960s based on experiments at this very laboratory. It's the foundation for firefighter training materials and for all of the modeling systems that people rely on to support decisions associated with fighting fire and fire management. One of the major limitations of it is that it doesn't explain how fires spread. It does not allow you to take into account the changing of fire behavior that goes along with changing wind conditions or changing moisture conditions or the variability in the vegetation or the fuel. We've been working towards replacing the Rothermel spread equation for many years. But one of the challenges is that the run times for this model are too slow. Maybe that means I'm not very good at it. I don't know. We began working with Google Research Partners a couple of years ago.
The two advantages that we really bring at Google are the large amount of compute that we have access to and the expertise in using it. Mark and his team have run the model on the compute that they have available to them, generating about a million data points. We were able to take Mark's model, run it on Google's infrastructure, and we've created hundreds of millions of data points. And then we've used that data to train up a deep neural network to come up with an approximation for what Mark's model does, that it's just much, much faster. So Mark's model can make a fire prediction in about a minute. Ours can make a prediction in about 20 to 30 milliseconds. And due to how AI works, we're not limited to just making a single prediction at a time, like Mark's model. In that same 20 milliseconds, we can actually make thousands of predictions.
Are these spotted or are these like...
The fire behavior modeling is often used in planning phases. Maybe there's a community that we're trying to protect and we want to do some kind of mechanical treatment or a prescribed burn. With these new modeling systems, we can simulate maybe 10,000 fires in a community under different weather and wind conditions and different locations of where the fire might start and start to identify areas of high significance. Like if we could change the fuel type in this area, that would really help firefighters when they're trying to suppress a fire. From this new model, we'll be able to teach firefighters what dryness does to a fire or wind or a change in fuel type, because we have seen so many firefighters die on fires when they don't anticipate what the fire's gonna do. And there could be some huge gains from something like FireSat, where we will get extremely good information about how fires spread, and we can use that to forecast fire behavior.
People turn to Google in times of crisis to get information about what to do next. And that's part of the reason why it's been so important for Google to have wildfire boundaries as a part of Google Maps and Google Search. Our wildfire boundary product shows wildfire boundaries using satellite imagery and AI. And what's so exciting about FireSat is that we can get a real step change and improvement in our ability to detect fires early and to detect small fires, which is very important for helping people stay as safe as possible.
Our hope is that FireSat will shine a light where there wasn't one before to really bring data to the world to make sure that everybody has equitable access to it and is able to actually achieve improvements to people's health and safety.
We were doing a FireSat presentation back in Washington, D.C., and the head of the International Association of Firefighters, a Boston character, was sitting in the audience, and excuse me if I fumble my Boston accent, but he said, "You mean to tell me that we'll get satellites for just the firefighters? Just for us? That's amazing! I want that to happen!"